Hey everybody, I'm very excited to be with you guys today, and I'm going to be going over the process that I use to create my Ron Burgundy piece. Before I do that though, I'm going to just quickly go over my setup, which is included on the Corel site under their workspaces. You can download the Illustrator workspace, which is essentially the setup that I have here in my studio with some of my favorite brushes. If you look over here, I have pencils, what I call essentials, which are my blenders, my oil pastels, airbrushes, my scratchboard tool, which I'll be talking about at length today, and some other brushes, and my mixer, and layers and channels. I don't have a whole lot of extra things on the screen at any one time because I like to keep it clear to make my images as large as I can in my reference material. So that being said, I'm going to go to my normal workflow, which is I'll go to my bridge, and the piece I'm going to do is Ron Burgundy. So I collect a lot of JPEGs and stuff online, images of him or whoever I'm going to be painting, just at different angles and things that I'll need. And usually just kind of put them together in a page. So I can pull that up. I'm going to do that in Painter. Open. Here it is. Okay. So let me get this out of the background because it's a little distracting, and I'll move the bridge as well. And then I'll also open my working illustration here, which I believe is right here. And I'm going to move this bridge because it's in the way here. So what I usually do is I'll start my piece with my line drawing, and it depends. Sometimes I'll do it in a sketchbook and scan it, but more often than not, I don't have a whole lot of time to complete a piece for a client, so I'll just draw it right in Painter. What I've done here is I knew that I'd be working with a lot of skin tones, so I did the line in a burgundy color. That I can overlay on my flesh tones, and it will, you know, it won't be too hard to see the paint below. I'm turning this down now so that the opacity is around 36. I don't need the hand, so I'm going to turn that off right now, and I'll lay in a color in the background. I'm going to show you how I do this right now. But I didn't want to go too crazy with the background. I just wanted pretty much to focus on him, but I knew I wanted it to feel kind of painterly. So I'm going to make a new layer, drop it down, and using these colors, I'm just going to eyedrop the colors here, which I have set up on my stylus. I'm using a Wacom tablet, by the way, an Intuos 4. And I have gone into my preferences and set the eyedropper for my stylus on the button here, so I can just select whatever color I want. And now that I have that, I'll go to my my oil pastel, which is what I tend to use to start blocking in color. And just start dropping in color here. This is underneath my line drawing, which is why you can still see my line. And my line should be set to multiply, which it is. So anything I put underneath of it, obviously, I'll still be able to see my reference here. And I just just going to lay in color. I don't focus on how, you know, I don't focus on the strokes too much. I just, again, I want it to be painterly. I might go in and use my blender and kind of just soften some of these edges a little bit. But that's the technique I use to pretty much end up with this piece here. Some of these harder lines that you're seeing were done by using my scratch board tool. This tool is something that, I mean, if I could use one tool in Painter and they didn't have the, you know, thousands of brushes, this would be the brush that I would probably just rely on the most. As you can see, it's I guess you can't see. I'm on the wrong layer, that's why. If I was to draw with it, it gives me a nice irregular pattern that when it overlays, depending upon, you know, the opacity, you can get some very interesting shapes. And that's how you're getting these things down here, these geometric shapes. And on top of that, I've gone in and used a real oil blender to give me some of the more brushy strokes. All right, so once that's done, once I get a basic undertone, I'll go in and start working on the jacket here, which I've locked in my colors simply by selecting selecting a group of reds. My mixer, you'll have to forgive me, my mixer is for some reason disappeared, but what I had was a set of flesh tones, and I had my reds, which I had pre-selected and made daubs on the screen. And I do this because I can just eyedrop and I don't have to go anywhere. I could use my temporal color picker, which I do quite often. That's a new feature to Painter 12, and it's really pretty awesome. I'll use that when I start going to colors that I don't have readily available in the skin and areas like the hair and things like that. But just to get started, I'll throw down these colors and just start knocking them in the jacket here. So I'm going to extend my layers. Oops. And the way I'll usually work is once I get something that I kind of like, I'll make a new layer and start painting on top of it. So if there's any mistakes or anything, I don't have to worry about destroying what's underneath. All right, so this brush that I'm using now is that scratch board tool I was telling you about. And rather than doing a whole lot of blending, what I'll normally do is eyedrop between the colors. Now, by that, what I mean is if I have a light tone here, let's say, if I have a light tone here and I have a dark tone here, and I brush one over the other, that overlying color that kind of is the mid-tone between them is something that I can go in and I can eyedrop and then kind of blend. And by doing that over and over again, I still get a really, really painterly edge, but it starts to blend those colors together where it, you know, I can get a decent gradation. And you'll see that a lot in my work. So over here in the arm, for example, I started off with a lighter tone, laid that down, and then put my dark tone down. And as I get closer to that area where I want them to start to blend together, you'll see I switch back and forth to the eyedropper. And by doing that, I get a really nice gradation. I could go in with my just add water or something and you know, just really blend it, which that works nicely, but, you know, I don't want it to feel digital in any way, and I really don't want to, you know, I don't want anybody thinking that it's airbrush or that I used any kind of, I don't know, computer methods to kind of fake some of this stuff. I guess the end result that I'm looking for is something that looks like it could be painted by hand outside the machine. So because of that, what I'll do is I'll stick to my scratch board and do my thing here.
Mike, I have a few questions that have come in. And Doug would like to know if you're using the exact same workspace that's available for download from our website.
I am. You know, I have moved a couple of the things around, sometimes by accident and sometimes on purpose. But, yeah, I actually downloaded that workspace and dropped it back on my machine when I upgraded my OS. So the answer is yes.
Great. And then John would like to know what your favorite new features in Painter 12 are.
I really like the new Navigator, which I closed for because it was in the way. But I use this quite a bit. I like the fact that I can rotate my page with the Navigator now. Not right now, but I can if I wanted to. I just don't want to. And zooming and things of that nature. I love the temporal color picker. That's a big one. And the real brushes. I mean, the brushes really are the star of Painter. So some of these real brushes give an effect that are you just can't get anywhere else. And I like that as well.
I know that we were discussing this the other day, but Dorothy has a question about the resolution that you're working at and canvas dimension in Painter.
Yeah, that's a great question. So a lot of times when I'm doing stuff for a client, they'll need it, you know, at 300 DPI, you know, at actual working size. So whether it be a toy package or a poster or whatever, I've got to work at that size. And just to give you an example, I worked on a piece for a large format. It was actually for Verizon. It was a 10-foot tall by 30-foot wide wall display. You know, clearly I couldn't work at that at full resolution, but it still had to be pretty high, and it choked my machine. When using Painter, I always put my resolution at 200 DPI while I'm working. And then when I'm done, I size it up to the 300. I was telling Tanya the other day, for whatever reason, I don't know what kind of magic is happening, but when I resize it, I don't get the pixelation that's normally associated with blowing something up and then trying to, fake the resolution. It seems to hold it pretty well. So by keeping it lower than I need, I'm taking up less memory and I'm able to navigate around the screen really quickly, and those brush strokes are all happening real time. I don't get any sluggishness or anything like that. I don't have a ton of time. So the next thing I do is I start blocking in. Everything at the beginning for me is blocking in colors. So, you know, if I was to turn off this line, it's a mess. But what I'm doing is I'm just, and I'm going to move this navigator again so you can see. I'm just looking for skin tones, whether it be in the shadow areas, and this is the face that I'm referencing here. And where's my line drawing for the face? Okay. So I start blocking in these colors with the scratch board tool. A lot of times, you know, I'll use greenish hues down in the jaw, where there might be like a razor stubble or growth or something like that, and then move up to the warmer tones around the nose and things things like that. Once those colors are all kind of blocked in, then I'll go on a new layer. I'm happy with this now. I think that pretty much is a good starting place. Then I'll turn on a new layer, and I start to refine that. You can see there's more detail here. I started blocking in the eyes, and really at this stage, I can see that the likeness is coming along fairly nicely. The pencil is still there, and that's going to remain there. I never really get rid of the line drawing, I usually make layers on top of that and begin to paint it out. So when I'm done, you're not going to see it. But at this stage, I can go and go above my line drawing here, which I've done, create a new layer, and you can see I start painting over the pencil, and you get a bit of a, you get it looking a bit more like the final piece is going to look.
Mike, do you take advantage of any of the extra Wacom pens, or are you just using the standard stylus with the Intuos 4?
It's a standard stylus. I thought about getting the,
The art pen.
Yeah, I thought about getting that. For some reason, I didn't. This one seems to do fine, and it comes with a pretty good array of different nibs that I can put in. I notice that I go through them fairly quickly, probably because of the pressure. Oh, you know what? I'm glad you said that, because that brings me back to something I do. Every time I start Painter, which is go to my preferences, to the brush tracking, and set my brush tracking. This is a trick that I picked up. I think I was watching a Ryan Church DVD, he had mentioned that, whenever you're starting a piece, you should go in and pretty much lay down a few strokes. Depending upon how you feel that day, you might be pressing a little harder on the tablet or not quite as hard, and then that's going to give you it's a custom feel, so that when I go in and paint now, the stroke is going to be exactly what I want. I don't have to press really hard, I don't have to press lightly because it's coming down, coming out too thickly. Also, I usually keep the opacity of my brush around between 10 and 30. That's pretty comfortable for me. So, another thing about this brush that I really like is it gives me unexpected strokes that, I couldn't really think of. So if I'm laying in a highlight here, and I look over on the edge here, and maybe like down here, for example, you see how I get a geometric shape. I don't mean to do that. Sometimes it really works out nicely, and it gives me a look that I might want to keep, like especially over here in the jaw or down here. It just helps you realize that, hey, this isn't just a photograph. This is a piece that's actually been painted. And that's one of the reasons that I use this brush, really, for the heavy lifting and all of my illustrations. So I'll just turn on a couple more layers here, and you can see once I get happy with my likeness, I can start laying in some of the finer details, the creases on his forehead, the parts of his mustache, the individual hairs and things like that, which it's good that I have reference over here that I can go back to.
Do you have any favorite artists of the past?
Like old masters?
Famous masters, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, probably Da Vinci and Michelangelo were two of the biggies that I always go back to, just pretty much for their the way that they drew the bodies and everything. It was really interesting to me. It seemed it seemed a little more better than the real thing, if that makes any sense. The proportions were always really nice, and I love the way that they did their women. They weren't, they had a little meat on their bones and came out nice in the paintings. I'm going to change the subject now before I see so anyway, I'm going to keep turning on layers here. And of course, if you're talking about more recent artists, people like Norman Rockwell is somebody that I constantly go back to and look at his work and try to pattern my stuff after. It's a whole lot of people. But so what I'm doing in some of these other layers, it gets more subtle, but essentially, say I have something that I like and I decide that I like this mustache, but it's too harsh, like you shouldn't be able to see the individual strands of the hair all over the place. Rather than going in with my blender, I'm using the Just Add Water, by the way. This dynamic sizing that I'm doing on the screen, I have also set up for my Wacom stylus. That's the toggle. I have it set for the rear toggle, and that's allowing me to do this is great because I change the size of my brush all the time. I change the color of my paint jobs all the time. So being able to do both of these things right in the stylus and not have to touch any other key, any other function on my tablet here, it just saves a load of valuable time for me. But what I was going to show you is I've made a clean layer here. Well, no, I haven't. I'm going to make one now. All right, so there's my layer, and I'm just going to call this blend. Okay. I've got my... why isn't it? Okay. I've got my blender here, and if I were to go in now and start softening this stuff, essentially, I could go in and blend it so much that it looks like a picture, but I don't want that. I think some of those shapes and hard areas of transition and color are interesting. So say I've done it, and I've gone over my number of undos. I can't go back and change this now. I'm like, oh, geez, I might have messed up the cheek, but I didn't really, because I can go now and switch to my eraser, and I'll set my eraser for a low opacity. Maybe like 20, or maybe higher, like 50. And I can go in and I can erase some of this blending back and get some of that original, those original transitions. So if I cut this off, you can see that there's some things happening around his cheek that I blended out. Well, maybe I want to keep some of it and I don't want to keep the other parts. I can erase what I don't want and keep the rest. And this is what I do. So if you look at these layers that are above here, 11 through 14, I have gone in and blended certain parts and kept others. And then I'll go in and put strokes on top of the layers that might have the blending so that it comes back to looking painterly once again. I do this over and over and over again until I get something I like. And the end result is something like this, where if you look at his chin, now you can see that I have the growth, I have some of the pinky areas in his, in his jowl. There's the green from the stubble, the shadow from his lip. And these are all things that if I tried to do it on one layer, it probably would have turned into a big muddy mess. Instead, I've done it on multiple layers, concentrating on one thing at a time and then going in and erasing areas that I've decided that I don't want to keep to bring the likeness back. And then you end up with something like that. So,
Lucy is wondering which brush you use for the mustache and the hair.
Sure, that's that scratchboard tool I was telling you about, and that's in my in the Illustrator workspace. So this scratchboard tool, if I turn it down to a smaller size and set my opacity. Well, I should probably get on a new layer here. Okay. So I'll set a highlight color here, and I decide to go in and start working in some of these strands. It's fantastic. I mean, I've used other brushes where I've just changed the diameter of it and tried to make a small brush, but then I'm getting something that looks more like a key line. The simple fact that by using less pressure, I get a thinner line, I can get these areas that are really believable for hair and stubble and things like that. Like, say I wanted to come down into his chin and, say he had some stubble going on. I can just work it, turn down my opacity, and work dark, and then bring my lights in and work the opposite.
I believe I already know the answer to this, but do you ever trace your photos or use the cloning feature in Painter?
I have traced photos before. Yeah, if I have a deadline where I know that I'm going to spend so much time on the render that I just can't take the time to do the drawing and worry about the likeness there, then yeah, I've done it. You know, I've used the cloning for I used it for a huge project for that Verizon piece. I had to do it's in the Meadowlands Stadium, and it's a crowd of people, which is on, like I said, that 10-foot tall by 30-foot wide wall, where I'm doing life-size people. And for that one, I had spent so much time painting the primary characters that for the crowd people that were in the background, I used my oil pastel, made it a cloner, and kind of cloned them in. Then I painted on top of it.
And what about, is your typical process to use layers, or do you stop and save a numbered working document while you're going
through? I do both of those. I always use layers. My bridge must have closed. I always use layers, but then whenever I get something that I'm fairly happy with, I'll save it off as an iteration. So, you know, this was an earlier one, and I liked it, and I saved it. It started as a pencil, and I'll just number and keep those versions until I get something that I'm pretty happy with. So then I started getting into the jacket here, and with the jacket, this is something that I kind of went back and forth with because I wanted to, he's got some nice tones in some of these pictures. I knew I wanted to rim light it, and I haven't completely finished that yet. But if we look at this picture, for example, some really great transitions of color between the lapel and the rest of the coat. So I went in with that, and using that scratch board tool, started laying down my basic tones. The layer that you're looking at here, where it starts to look a bit more refined, that's where I've gone in and done a little bit of blending, gone back over with the scratch board tool, and done the blending between the lights and the darks here. You can see it in the lapel. Gone in on another layer, started adding some of the lights, and this is the process. I mean, I go back and forth until I get something that ends up looking pretty close to what I want it to look like. You can see I started the tie here. I didn't really spend a whole lot of time on it, and it's the channel 4 news pin. And this is all that scratch board tool. You know, if you zoom in really close, you can see that come up on it here. By using that tool, I can go in and get however much or little detail that I want, and work it in. Now, clearly, it's going to be seen at, you know, like that size. So I don't want to go too crazy. But that's what I'm doing.
So, do you always save your files as PSD?
I do. Because I don't really use the watercolor that much, I'm not saving them off as RIP files. Because there's so many layers, I don't save them off as TIFFs until I'm done with everything and I can compress it. But I'll make sure that I have plenty of saved versions where I have all of those layers intact before I get to that stage. So what I wanted to show you is, at this point, I know I want to have him being interviewed, right? So I have this hand with a mic. I've done a knockout layer underneath of that, and essentially what that is the hand is my pencil line. I've gone in and selected this background color, like a tone of that, and just brushed it in on top of Ron, but underneath of the line. And so you can see what it looks like there. So if I go my reference here somewhere, up, oh, there it is. So there's my hand. So I'm actually going to show you what I do here. Go back to my drawing.
There are some questions coming in about the mediums that you use. As far as InPainter, it's appearing that the scratchboard tool and the Just Add Water here and there are your main tools of choice. Is that indeed the case?
It is. Under my essentials, these are my core brushes, the mic essentials. So I've got my oil pastel, which I use to block this in, and I'm going to use it in a second to show you how I start blocking those skin tones in. That's first. Then I go in with my scratchboard tool. That's pretty much most of everything else between that and the blender, just kind of softening it and then going back in and adding some harder lines. But those brushes are, those three brushes, if I couldn't use anything else, those are the ones that get me through most of my work.
And do you ever use traditional media anymore, or is everything that you do digital?
You know, it's funny because I feel bad. I see these people who are, you know, I friends and illustrator friends who are on Facebook and Twitter who are still doing stuff by hand that are, it's amazing, and it makes me want to break out my old acrylics. So I went and bought these canvases, which unfortunately have been sitting next to my TV in the basement for about 2 years, just waiting for me to get up and actually use them. The good and bad of it is I've been so busy I haven't had time to. So it's good that I'm getting paid, but it's bad that I'm kind of forgetting the roots here. I don't know, this feels like painting to me, so whatever. All the same techniques I use outside the computer I use in. I think that's the mark of somebody that you can tell began as a traditional artist, is that when you look at their work and the end result of their work, it feels like something that could have been created outside. So I'm going to go in, and now if I had my mixer palette intact, I would just go ahead and select. I have all of my flesh tones for pretty much every ethnicity are in my mixer palette, which I believe is in the Illustrator workspace. It should all be there. If you open it, it should be there. That's where I would normally select, but because I don't have it and I don't have a lot of time, I'm just going to select some colors from this guy here. I'll just eyedropper some things. I noticed that when I am painting, people with particular light, particular skin tones, I'll use a different color under bases. For this guy, he seems to have some gray under his skin here, so I like that, and I'm going to keep it in certain areas. And then, you know, there's other areas that clearly are more red. It's not selecting. Oh, there it is. But the thing that I tend to do is just block in a lot of varied colors. I don't want to stick with just, okay, this is a skin tone. I'm going to lay down a skin tone and be done with it and then try to figure it out later. If I lay down these tones now and make it very mottled at this point, then I can, there's yellows over here. Then I can, I don't have to worry about that later, you know. I have all of my information there, and all I have to do is figure out how to make it presentable. And that's it, you know. Lay that in. get my grays over here. Let's block that in. And at this stage, I don't really worry about going outside the lines too much. Because it's on its own layer, I can just go back and erase it. It's no biggie. And I tend to stay away from the darker tones until the end because, you know, clearly it's making it hard to see that black line. So I want to save that for last. So the brush that I'm using now is the oil pastel. This is great because the way that it lays down, according to the, you know, how much pressure you're using, you get some really, you know, really natural transitions between the pigment. And again, I'm using it at I believe 30%. That's right. Yeah, it's like 30% opacity. So now once that's done, you know, it's okay. Let me put some of these darks in from the microphone down here because this will be dark.
Are you setting all of the layers that you add to the multiply blending mode?
No, not at all. The only ones that are set to multiply are pencil. That's it.
Okay.
I don't... And in fact, I don't really go in and do too much, too many layer effects, changing to, you know, like screen or overlay, things like that, because when I start to go in and merge those layers, if you don't do it right, then it's going to mess up the piece. So say, for example, I had a highlight on here that's done on screen, you know, screen method of, you know, the layer blending. If I set it for screen, not that one, it's default.
You can also set the individual brush strokes. You can take advantage of those merge modes in Painter 12 now. And I don't know if you've experimented at all, but just thought I'd mention it.
Yeah, I have. I actually talked about that a little bit. I had to do that write-up for Imagine FX where I was talking about some of the features of Painter 12.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the ones that I really like. I do it from time to time. It's, you know, the thing with Painter or Photoshop or any application that you're learning is that it's one of those things for me that the only way that I learned how to do it was I hone in on like a core set of features that I can go back to and I know that, all right, I have to do this piece for whoever. It's due next week. If I concentrate on these certain sets of features, then I can make it through this thing and hit my deadline. And then as I finish and get more free time, then I go in and I learn one more thing. And this week now I'm learning this and that and the other until finally I get it down. It was really overwhelming when I first started using Painter and I saw everything it could do and all the brushes and the methods that you could combine, the brush settings to make them individual, you know, even outside of what they already could do, I was just like, whoa, I can't deal with this. It's too much. So the way I get around that is I grab a few things that I'm comfortable with, get past using those, and then I move on to the rest of it. I have this layer here. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think that you're very similar to most other artists out there where initially in Painter, you should really take the time to experiment with the tools that are there, find out which ones you like, and that ends up being your core tool set in the end. Do you ever use pickup underlying color?
Yeah, it's, oh, well, it should be on. I always use it. I thought I had it on. You know what, with the new icon, sometimes I forget that it's not turned on here. But yeah, absolutely. I'm going to skip this point I was going to make about screen because it's really not all that important. All you need to know is that if I had some of these methods set to soft light or multiply or things like that, and I go in and I merge layers, I never just merge all my layers at once. I usually just, if I'm happy with my jacket, say I like jacket 2 through 3, I'll go through and I'll select those three and then I'll merge them. If one of those is set to a different combination mode, like it's a hard light or a screen or something like that, and I merge those three, it screws the way that they interact with all the other layers up now, and it doesn't work. So that's the really long way of getting around to answer your question about is everything set to multiply. All right, so going back, you know, I would just...
So I think you just turned on preserve transparency. Yep, that right there.
That's what it is.
You did okay, have so no, pickup did underlying have color.
I did have it on. Okay, mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I use it all the time. I still have preserve transparency.
There you go.
Okay. Oh, you know what? I'm painting under. That explains it. That would explain it. All right. So now, as you can see, I blocked in some colors. I'm kind of cool with that. I would go in and make a new layer at this point. Switch to my scratchboard tool. Up the size. And go in and just start to detail. Move this over because it keeps... There you go. All right, start to detail. And now, you see, when I touched the screen right there, that odd shape that went down, that was just the brush interacting with me placing it down. I like that. Like, I like that a lot. So, I mean, I'll keep those areas. And sometimes I'll just go in and I'll just dab down. Like, this dude's hand looks kind of liver spotted here. So I'll dab down these tones, depending upon, you know, whether they need to be there or not. And I get these interesting areas of color that I'll end up keeping, you know. I have the opacity turned down really low right now, so that's why it's allowing me to go in and get these interesting laydowns here. So turn it up now, and I'll start working on the shading and work the form. Okay, I'm over the hand. I don't mean to be over the hand. I need to be under. And just by working this way, you can see that, you know, after I put enough time in, it starts to actually look like a hand and the forms start looking right. Most of what I'm doing, though, is just constantly referring back to my source image and seeing where I need to add lights or bump up the, you know, push the darks in until I get something decent. I'm not going to paint this entire hand, but... That's my emails. That's the process. And that's all I did with him. Just by going in and working it over and over again, you start to get it to look believable. Same thing with the hair. You know, I lay in my darkest tone, actually my mid-tone first. I'll work in some of the darker areas in the shadow. And using that scratchboard tool, I'll just push up lighter and lighter until I get to the highlight areas. So what I did want to do, and I'll do it now, is, you know, the reason I get so much reference is that, you know, I like his hair in this picture, I like his expression, but I want to go in and get some really nice rim lighting. I like the way that light's bouncing off his hair there. So come back over here and make a new layer. Originally this background was blue. It was a grayish blue color. And so I decided to lose that, but I'm going to keep it as my lighting. Come over here. Oops. Move this down. Rotate the page a bit so I don't have to contort my wrist too much. And turn down my opacity. Start hanging in some of these highlight colors.
There's a question from John asking how you handle paintings that are more of a caricature, similar to Jason, and I'm not sure how to pronounce his name, Seiler.
Oh, sure. It's the same process. You know, the only difference is the drawing. It's a skeleton underneath. So if I was doing a piece like the Bernie Madoff piece I did, which, you know, it's on my blog. I'm sorry. How much time do we have left, Tanya? We doing okay?
You have as much time as you would like. That we generally, try to keep it to an hour, which leaves you about 8 minutes.
Okay. All right. Well, the technique is the exact same. I just go in and use a more caricature drawing style on the early stage, and then the end result is more of a Seiler type of a look. Great artist, by the way, one of my favorites. So at this stage, I can start, laying in some of these little irregular hairs or whatever. And the great thing is it's on its own layer, so if I do something I don't like that shape I just got there, that was because the brush did its own thing. Here I don't want it, so I would just go in and erase it. You know, kind of dial back some of these areas that might look a little heavy. But once that, once I get that to looking kind of the way that I want it to look, I'll come in with another layer and I'll add a hard white on top of it to give this kind of a look. I'm telling you, this brush is doing a lot of it for me. I've done a lot of portraits, so I know what to look for, but if I was doing this without the brush, it would take me a lot longer to get this type of a look. So when it's done, you get something that's like that. Now, I don't like that at all, but you see how I do it. Yeah, that sucks. I'm getting rid of it. So what I would like to do is, because we're running out of time, whoa, that hand looks like a zombie hand now that I look at him. The colors are way off. I'm going to get rid of this color here. I'm going to add the knockout pack. And what I wanted this to feel like was a poster when I was done. Thus the white border. And I was going to add my type here, which I did. Oops. So just a little something that Ron Burgundy might say.
Very nice, Mike. So how long would it take you to actually finish, or how long did it take you to finish this entire painting?
To get to this point, it took me, maybe 12, 15 hours. And again, it could have gone a lot faster, but the bulk of it was going back in and painting his face over and over and over again. With my likenesses, I get very kind of anal about making sure that you can tell who it is. And so generally I'll paint a face and go back into it time and time again until I'm happy with it. And so that's it. I did want to show a snippet of the video. I recorded this entire paint session, and I eventually would like to post it up on maybe my Filter Foundry site. But I wanted to show you guys, run through it real quickly, how I did that, if I could. And I'm going to scrub through it, but it'll allow you to see. As you can see here, that's my oil pastel laying down my color. I have a second oil that I go in with. It's got that triangular shape, and I like that for the blending method. So I use that, kind of just work in and out of that background. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the background. Let's get into the face. All right, so there are those color dabs that I was telling you about, daubs that I was telling you about earlier. And I'll usually lay in my, the highlight shadows and the more pinkish tones that I can just dip into over and over again. When I'm comfortable with the face and the skin tones, those will go. I'll get rid of them, and then I'll just eyedropper from the actual skin. So, just pushing back some of the darker areas with those more ruddy colors first. And I'm working the layers. The same technique I showed you for that microphone in hand is what I'm doing here. And this is a good time that if there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer them, Tanya.
Graham asked me, he was just mentioning that he has trouble choosing backgrounds when it has to be less detailed, and I was trying to offer some suggestions just as far as tools to select, whether it be oil pastels that you've used here or chalks, and then you can use blenders to subtly blend it in.
Absolutely, that's all I do. You know, unless something has to have a specific background, I'm just quickly throwing in something with some tones with my oil pastels or some of the real brushes. Like, say I want to have more of a look that the actual bristles left on the page, I'll go in, and I think even maybe in this area I might have played around with the real brushes and lay those things in. But I don't want to, My whole job is based around getting something to a client in a timely manner, and I know that as an artist, I'm just not fast. I'm not a really fast painter. I admire the hell out of people who can do a portrait and knock it out in no time. I think Siler's one of those guys. He's really fast and good too, but that's not me. So what I'll do is try to find ways to cut corners. Whether it be, making sure I have all of my reference right in front of me so I don't have to interpret anything, or making sure my line drawing is just perfect before I begin. That's one of the things I do, you know.
Do you lean toward, pardon me?
Oh, no, go ahead.
Do you tend to lean towards complementary colors for backgrounds, or do you sample from within the image and pull that out?
That's a great question. You know, I think probably my weakest area is color theory. I never really focused on that when I was in school, and I wish I had. I shoot from the hip with colors, a lot. That's why with this background it started as blue, and The reason it started is that light blue was. I knew it had to feel like it was vintage. This thing is supposed to happen in the, you know, take place in the 70s. So I wanted to use those type of pastel colors that you might see then. And I also liked the fact that I knew that those blues would come in handy in his skin as well. But after I got to this point, I was like, it doesn't really, it's not working for me. So that's when I went in and color adjusted to that more of a sepia background that you see in the final piece. So you can see it turning on the pencil, turning it off. And these are all things that that take place before I get into the detailing. Everything here is just knocking in colors, just blocking everything in. All of the tones that I see under his jowl there, in his neck. I get really skittish about doing a skin tone that doesn't have a whole lot of colors in it. It just doesn't look, you know, it doesn't look right to me unless it's got a whole bunch of reds and blues and greens. And that's the same whether it's a, you know, a Caucasian person, African American, whoever. They all have a whole bunch of colors in the skin. So I'm gonna jump forward a little bit, well, maybe not that much, just to where the eye starts to take shape here. Like seeing these types of things is what's interesting to me, where you go from, you know, it's clearly a drawing to, okay, that looks like maybe it could be an eye, you know, to the finished piece. So were there any other questions, Tanya?
Yes. Do you do all of your work in studio, or do you take your laptop on the go?
You know, I did travel and paint while I was away. I used to have a PowerBook that it was a 17-inch, and it was nice, but I don't travel that much now, so I pretty much do everything in studio. I got an iPad, and I started painting on that. You know, I'm just waiting for Wacom to come out with a pressure-sensitive iPad accessory, you know. But
I know that you started painting digitally in the 90s, and you're fairly new to Painter, but can you remind me, we have a question about exactly when you started off with Painter, and have you played around with Photoshop at all also?
Oh, absolutely. So really quickly, like I started off as just a traditional painter using acrylics. I would paint on maybe 8.5 by 11 board, cold press board, and acrylics was my medium of choice. When I started working digitally, we had Photoshop. God, what was it? Maybe it might have been 3 or 4. It was a while ago. I just showed my age. But that's what I was using. I've been using Photoshop for a long time. Like up until 4 years ago, I was solely Photoshop, and then I switched to Painter. And then since then, I've been using Painter ever since. I've had every version of Painter. I just, again, that the interface to me before, I think, version 8 or 9, it was just too overwhelming. So even though I had it, I was scared, to be honest with you. I didn't know what was going on. It was too much to take in. When it switched over to more of a Photoshop-like type of interface where I could relate, that's when I just forced myself to dive in and just, you know, get wet.
Have you experimented? I know with the latest version of Photoshop, they added the mixer brushes in. Have you tried those at all? Just wondering, you know, if you have any thoughts. There's a question about a comparison between Painter and Photoshop.
Yeah, you know, I have a CS5, to be really honest with you, I'm not the guy to ask. I did try to play around with them to see what the you know, how close or how similar the end result was. In fact, that Tyson piece that I started was in, you know, I started it in Photoshop, and I got really frustrated, and then I went back to Painter. So I know that I see people doing some amazing things that look pretty real, I mean, natural, but I haven't quite had time to learn it myself. I think Siler, well, no, I know for a fact Siler uses Photoshop, and his stuff is very painterly. So this is the, I mean, this is the process, you know. It's a lot of choosing one area at a time, getting that to a semi-finished state, moving on to the next area, and then when I'm happy with that, I'll make a new layer and start going back on top of it. So when you look at the piece really close like this, you can tell that you know, you can see where I got, you know, how I got there. And when you back out, it just looks really, really detailed. So I love to work close like this and then back out. And that's how it gives me the particular look to my style.
When you first started painting, did you take painting classes, or are you self-taught?
I took classes when I was little. I've always been drawing, so you know, I don't remember not creating art, whether it was superheroes or you know, Star Wars, whatever. I was always drawing something in school and at home, and I did take a I took an oil painting class, and then I took a correspondence class that I just remember it was very expensive, and I lost interest quickly, and my parents were very upset with me. But it was that draw the turtle or pirate or whatever it was on the back of matches, and they're like, hey, you know, you could be an artist. And that's why I'm an artist today. So just so you know. Because of that box of matches. So it starts to come together. I'm not going to bore you guys. It's pretty much more of the same. See if I can get into some of these hair areas, because that'll show you the brush. Yeah, down here in the mustache. So for me, the I think the hardest part about doing these portraits is, you know, knowing when you're done, and you know, knowing when something might just be too harsh. I remember doing a portrait of it was the Coke piece, and I had to paint the singer Emile LaRue, and I thought I had it pretty well, but what happened is I went and focused on all of the parts of her face, didn't zoom back and look at it in its entirety, and it was all of those transitions were just too hard, and it made it look older than it should have. You know, so at that point I just went in and did a bit of blending and softened up some of those areas, and that made it. Here it's just me focusing on looking at all of those photos over and over again and deciding, is, you know, is his nostril right, and are his eyes right. The one weird thing I noticed about Will Ferrell, I never painted him before, is that he's got some odd eyes. They're like cat-shaped almost, and they're not straight. Like, if you look at them, they're not really symmetrical, which is awesome. You know, I think that stuff makes a more interesting portrait, but I never knew that about, you know, about him before.
Do you think it's important to do life drawings and paintings outside of just working from photo reference?
Yeah, it helped me. I learned a lot by doing that in college. We didn't nearly get as many women as we did men, which was unfortunate, but it did help.
I can see how you could just keep working on this and working on this.
Yeah, and I apologize if it's starting to get...
No, it's your perfectionist ways.
Oh, you know, one thing I do want to point out, like now as I look at this part right here, I blended it too much. So I'm looking in his cheek and under his lip and everything, and everything is just looking really soft to me. So you're right, I went all the way up to this point, and then I think I repainted over this entire area again to try to get some of those details back. Let's see. No, I don't even have them in this part of the video. Like if I go back to Painter, you can see I went in and repainted that whole area to try to get that stuff back. So I don't know. You got to be a little obsessive to make good art, I think. But that's it.